Hello and God bless you. Good morning and welcome to Santa Clarita Christian Fellowship. If I were to say I'm excited, you'll say, you're excited every week. Well, I am. And I'm excited today that you're with us. We're worshiping together online and we're making ourselves into a congregation online, even though we're separated from each other physically. To our special guests, thank you for being here with us. I want you to engage in all levels of the service. We're going to go into praise and worship in just a moment, but first let's pray. Father God, thank you so much for the gathering of your people. Thank you so much for keeping us safe, allowing us to see this day. Lord, we want to worship you. We want to lift high your name. We want to prepare the atmosphere for prayer by praise and worship. So please, Lord God, be glorified in what we do. You receive the glory, the honor, and the praise. In Jesus' mighty name, amen. Now again, our special first-time guest, text me at 661-298-8189. Let me know that you're here so we can acknowledge you. Thank you much. Now let's go into praise and worship, and I'll be right back after that.
Pray that everything that is coming to you, God, it flows directly, God. We love you, Lord. Thank you. Flow to you. Let the river of my worship flow to you. Lord, I pray in all I do that the river of my worship flows to you. Like streams in the valley, may it swell.
are worthy to be praised. Hallelujah. Thank the Lord. Worship Him again. Worship Him. Call you holy, your name is holy, you are so holy to me. I call you holy,
I call you holy.
Your name is holy,
your name is holy.
Holy you are,
holy you
and holy
are.
You
and
be.
Holy you
hallelujah, thank you, Lord. We bless your name, hallelujah. I call you holy.
Hear my heart's cry. I'm dead.
behold you as my King. For your glory, I will do anything just to see you, yeah. To behold you as my King. Lord, if I find favor, find favor in your sight. Lord, please, Lord, please, hear my heart's cry. I'm desperately waiting just to be where you are. I'll cross the hottest desert. I'll travel near or far for your glory. Hallelujah. I will do anything just to see you and to behold you as my King for your glory. Thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Lord.
Jesus. I worship you, God, because of who you are. I give you glory because of who you are. I give you praise. Oh, because of who you are, I will lift my voice and say, Lord, I worship you because of who you are. Oh, Lord, I worship you just because of who you are. Mm-hmm. Hallelujah. Thank you.
Because of who you are, I give you glory.
Oh, Lord, I give you glory because of who you are.
Because of who
thank you
are,
I give you all my praise. Oh, because of who you are.
Jehovah
Rapha, hallelujah, you're my healer.
You're my healer.
Thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord.
Now it's time for prayer. I believe that the atmosphere has been appropriately set for the time when we come to our Heavenly Father. We've praised His name. We've lauded and applauded Him. We've sung about His goodness and His greatness and His mercy and told Him how much we love Him. And we mean that for sure. So now it's a great time for us to come into prayer. And there are a number of things we want to cover. Are we living in a complicated world? You bet. But there's nothing beyond the capability of God. Praying for our leaders, praying for what's happening politically in the nation and in our various communities. Nothing is too big. Nothing's beyond His capability. Whatever God's going to do, He's going to do it. But we want to engage the weapons of our warfare, which are spiritual weapons. There are also some practical things, names available. You'll see them on the prayer list. Remember those names and pray for them. Then finally, as you're gathered in your homes or by yourself or on the phone or connecting with your friends, let's pray for those names that are on the prayer list, and let's pray for one another. God is able to do abundantly beyond all that we might think or ask. So let's go forward in the time of prayer right now. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you. Prayer changes things. And I'm excited about the fact that there are angels already being dispatched, doors being opened, ways made, that God is commanding and putting all things in order. And I'm looking forward to you sharing some of the requests that have been answered. Maybe email me sometime and tell me what the Lord has done. Testify about the greatness of God. Now we're coming to the time of worship through giving. We ought to give the Lord a hand praise. We're excited about that. God has kept us, blessed us, and done some tremendous things for us. And we count it a privilege and an honor to be able to return some of what He has given us back into His ministry. We believe that God has provided everything that we have, our daily bread and more, jobs, income streams, opportunities, ways made, checks that popped up that we didn't even know anything about. God does some tremendous things. And so in recognition of that, and in obedience to His word, we want to return a portion of what God has given us. And we utilize two different methods. One is called the tithe, which is 10% of our income. And the other is a free will offering, which is not any specific amount, just as the Lord lays it on your heart. Now, both of these are given on a free will basis. This is not about legalism or any of that kind of stuff. When you believe that God really has provided for you and you're able to do that, then you count it a privilege and an honor to return the tithe unto Him. And there are many blessings associated with that. You believe that God has blessed you, you count it a privilege and an honor to give a free will giving. That's why we're not telling you, okay, $5 line and $10 line and $15 line. No, we don't handle it that way. And God has blessed us tremendously for obeying His word. Now, before we get into the praying portion, those of you who are guests of ours, I want to invite you to be a part of this as well. We have a number of different ways for you to participate. Electronic means, of course. Very usable now that we are online. Venmo, PayPal, Zelle, and Cash App. All of those work just fine. You'll see the details on the screen. If you want to send a check using traditional giving, cash or check, make your check out to SCCF Church. P.O. Box 800215, Santa Clarita, California, 91380. It's there on the screen. Now let's pray. Father God, thank You for once again allowing us the opportunity to partner with You, to return a portion of what You've given us into this ministry. Lord God, thank You that You'll bless these gifts and the giver of the gifts so that we may continue to do Your work. Lord God, I'm aware that under the sound of my voice, there may be those who are struggling financially. Many people have lost their jobs, different things like that because of this situation. Lord, look upon their situation. Open doors, make a way. Our various stresses involved right now, Father. We know that You can handle it. And so we just want to bring that before You and thank You for Your ability to handle that. In Jesus' name we pray. All right, now let's put a big smile on your face and let's give in Jesus' name. Thank You so much.
You're invited to join us on Saturday, October 31st, 5 p.m. to 7 p.m. for the SCCF Goodie Bag and Candy event. We're happy and pleased to provide a safe alternative for our families and our youth and our neighbors. So come on out and be a part of it. Bring a friend, invite a neighbor. Looking forward to seeing you at Santa Clarita Christian Fellowship on Saturday, October the 31st from 5 to 7 p.m.
Just another quick note as we prepare for the holiday season. I'm here to announce that Santa Clarita Christian Fellowship will be supporting Operation Christmas Child. we are determined to be a blessing to some deserving young child. This year, we will have to work a little bit harder. You will need to purchase and pack your own box. That means more time on your behalf, but the effort is well worth it. You can choose to provide gifts that are suitable for a boy or a girl. You pack the gift box and include a check for $9 payable to Samaritan's Purse. Then you deliver the completed box or boxes to Santa Clarita Christian Fellowship on Saturday, November 7th or Sunday, November 8th. Then you get the joy of blessing a child and sharing the love of God this Christmas season. A lot more work, but a lot more reward. So watch out for your email or text where you'll see a reminder with the details. Make a decision today that you will be a part of this wonderful way to show that SCCF cares. God bless you, and let's do a great job on this.
Before we get ready for the time of the sermon, I just want to remind you and to encourage you to get ready for the first Sunday in November. Wow, it seems like this month is just powering on by, but we can be thankful that we are here today together in the name of Jesus. We are alive and healthy, and thank God for everything that He's doing. 2020 is going to come together very quickly, just like that. So for next Sunday, first Sunday, we have our virtual communion. I want to encourage you to make sure you get your grape juice and your unleavened bread so that you can participate. You know, this is a great time for us to be together as a family. And you in your household, I want to encourage you to take communion together and to celebrate what the Lord is doing in us and through us. So don't forget, make sure you're ready next week for First Sunday Communion. God bless you. And now it's time for the Word of God. I want to encourage you today to be encouraged by the sermon. I want to encourage you to be praying for the preacher as he shares the Word of God. I need God's power to be able to deliver the Word of God. I want to encourage you also to take notes during the course of the sermon. Write it down. Clip the details on your phone if that's an easy way to do it. I discovered something really incredible. My wife thought it was funny the other day that I could do a text by talking into it, and then it would just go right ahead and give the words. I was like, wow, technology is fantastic. So I encourage you to use every means that you have available to retain the Word of God. But let's first pray. Father God in heaven, I thank you for this day that you have made. There is no one like you, Lord God, for the privilege and the honor of declaring your word. We thank you. We are aware of the weakness in our body and our lack of capability and human standpoint, but Lord, we know that we can do all things through Christ who strengthens us, and this certainly applies to the Word of God. So my prayer, Lord, is that you would stand in my body and speak through my mouth. Let your word find good ground. If there's anybody here today who does not know you, in the pardon of their sins, let this day be the first day of the rest of their life, born again into the kingdom of God. We ask and pray this in Jesus' mighty name. Amen. Now, I want to invite you to participate and to make an effort to participate in the sermon by reading along with the slides and so forth. I know that it's difficult sometime on Sunday morning. If you sit down on the couch, you can fall asleep. It has nothing to do with the preacher. The couch just has a way of putting anybody to sleep if you don't pay attention to it. So engage yourself by writing, walking around a little bit. Keep yourself engaged because you want to get the Word of God. Now, if you're able to stand without great difficulty, would you do so? I want you to read the screen version. Here I have the scripture text taken from Genesis chapter 12, verse 1, and I'll read it. It says, "Now the Lord had said to Abram, get thee out of thy country and from thy kindred and from thy father's house unto a land that I will shew thee. And I will make of thee a great nation, and I will bless thee and make thy name great, and thou shalt be a blessing. And I will bless them that bless thee, and curse him that curseth thee, and in thee shall all families of the earth be blessed." Repeat after me. May the Lord add a blessing to through the reading and the hearing of his holy and mighty word. We are continuing our studies through the book of Genesis in the series entitled Selected Sermons from the Book of Genesis. This is teaching number 36, and because the book is so wonderfully rich and full with information, the Lord has blessed us to be able to share several insightful teachings based on just the first 12 chapters of this book. And it is a truly amazing book. We've skipped over some of the sections of the book. We've jumped over a lot of the details of how the human race expanded upon the earth and populated the earth after the great flood. Here we pick up where we left off in our last sermon, looking at a well-known and very important biblical character by the name of Abram or Abraham. The last sermon from this book dealt with the issue of the call to separation that was placed upon the life of Abram. And in that sermon, we learned that we as Christians are called to a life of separation. Again, that does not mean that you got to move out to a cabin in the woods somewhere in upstate Idaho, but rather the call to separation is a call to disengage from those things in this world and the attachments of this world, and to come to a place, watch this, where our sole and primary focus is on God and God alone. That's the call to separation. And that sermon was challenging. I understand it was challenging on some levels because it confronted us about some of the choices that we need to make in terms of our various relationships. It confronted us about how comfortable we can become with the trapping and pleasures of this world. If you missed that sermon, I encourage you to check it out online at mysccf.com/sermons. Today, we are going to look at the person of Abram to learn and to be encouraged by God's great promises. This is a word of encouragement today, a word to every born-again believer who, in fact, is a child of Abraham by faith. So take notes, hear what the Spirit is saying, and be ready to say amen. If you're ready to go, say, go ahead, preacher, let's go through the sermon. 5 points to the sermon today, and then we'll be finished. Genesis shows us, number one, a picture of God's great promise to Abram, as seen, number one, in the promise of land. There we going to read from Genesis chapter 12, verse 1. It said, "Now the Lord had said to Abram, get thee out of thy country and from thy kindred and from thy father's house unto a land," here it is, "that I will show thee." Faith comes by hearing, hearing by the word of God. Hebrews chapter 11, verse 8. I know I'm going kind of fast for those of you who don't have the slides, but again, I encourage you to write these scriptures down. Go back and read them if you like. Here they are on the screen. It says, "By faith, Abraham, when he was called to go out into a place which he should after receive an inheritance," watch this, "obeyed and went out," here it is, "not knowing whether he went." Hebrews chapter 11, here it is. It says, "For he," meaning Abraham, "looked for a city which has foundations," here it is, "whose builder and maker is God." From Romans chapter 4, verse 13, it says, "For the promise that he should be heir of the world was not to Abram or to his seed through the law, but through righteousness of faith." Here it is, one more scripture. Here it is. First is John. This is John chapter 14. Here it is. It says, "In my father's house, there are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you." This is Jesus talking. "If I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, there you may be also." Here in this first point, we look at and learn about the promised reality of God on the life of Abraham, who is calling Abraham to the promised land. God had placed a call on the person of Abraham, watch this, in order to position him and the nation that would spring from him in a land that was flowing with milk and honey, a land of promise that God had determined would be inherited by his chosen people. The promise and vision of God in terms of Abram and the children that would spring forth from him was a promised land. It was a physical land, watch this, but it was also the promise of a spiritual land. This is where you and I, as born-again children of God, should get excited, because the promise of God was made, and it points to, watch this, it points to the ultimate promised land. Come on now, the ultimate promised land is called heaven. There in Hebrews chapter 11, verse 8, it says, by faith, Abram was called to receive an inheritance. Romans chapter 4, verse 13 says that it was not through the law, watch this, but through righteousness of faith. Jesus said, in my Father's house, there are many mansions. Jesus said that he was going back to heaven, meaning the promised land, to prepare a place for us, a place for you and me. That is the promise that Jesus was talking about, and the promise that was established, watch this, and can now be embraced by faith by every born-again child of God who is a child of Abraham by faith. God would not only save Israel and bring them to be with him in heaven, but the promise and the plan and the vision included you and I, watch this, who are not the physical descendants of Abraham, but are nonetheless equally members of that blessed family because we were adopted as sons and daughters by faith in Jesus Christ, God's own son. The promised land, the promised land, the promised land for you and me, my friends, is heaven. It's a promised land. It's a place where there will be no sickness. It's a land of promise where you and I will be with the Father. We will be protected from hatred and harm. The promise of a new land, watch this, says Peter, is reserved for us, kept in heaven, sealed and secured by the power of the Holy Ghost. It's there for us, reserved in heaven for God who's going to bring us home. And for that reality, every child of God ought to give God a hand praise. Every child of God who's listening to this ought to give God some praise because he has called us into the promised land. Genesis shows us a picture of God's great promises to Abraham as seen secondly in the promise of a new physical and spiritual heritage. We get that from preacher. Here it is on the screen. It says, and I will make of thee a great nation. God talking to Abraham. Now watch this. Faith comes by hearing and hearing by the word of God. As for me, behold, my covenant is with thee, and thou shalt be, here it is, a father of many nations. Neither shall thy name any more be called Abram, but thy name shall be called Abraham, for a father of many nations I have made thee. Galatians chapter 3, verse 7 says, know ye therefore that they which are of faith, the same are the children of Abraham. Watch what I said earlier. I said we're the children of Abraham by faith. There it is in Galatians chapter 3, verse 7. Galatians chapter 3, verse 14, it says, that the blessing of Abraham might come upon the Gentiles through Jesus Christ, that we might receive the promise of the Spirit. Watch this, through faith. Here in the second point, We look at it and we examine the words of God. We examine the words of God to Abram, watch this, regarding the blessing of a physical and a spiritual heritage. In this portion of scriptures, God is promising Abram to make him the father of a great nation. Watch this, but at this time, Abram did not have any children. Here, God is speaking prophetically of that blessed race that we know as the Jews who would flow from the loins of Abraham and be born to his wife Sarah, who would later give birth to a son. Watch this, when she was 90 years old, and Abram was 100. The promise of God to Abram was the physical and literal promise of a heritage through whom would come a blessed son. To the Bible readers here today who know that Abraham would have two sons, one by the name of Ishmael, who would become the father of the Arabs, and another named Isaac, who would father Jacob, who would later become the father of Israel, the nation of Israel. As of 2018, demographers estimate that there are approximately 14.6 million people in the world who are connected by physical heritage to the Jewish population. Watch this. And PopulationReview.com said over 400 million people in the world identify themselves as Arabs. Now, the promise of God to Abram really surrounded the nation of Israel. God promised that there would be a race that was set apart, a group of chosen people through who would come the Savior of the world. But the promise of God was not just limited to a physical nation of chosen people who were called the Jews. Watch this. But the promise also pointed, here it is, it also pointed to a spiritual nation. And it is to that nation that you and I can lay claim, because we are the born-again children of God through faith. We can lay claim and we can celebrate on this wonderful God-blessed morning. You see, my friends, you and I are called. We are the children of Abraham. Watch this. Because of our spiritual connection. One of my closest friends in this world is my buddy Steve. We've been friends for almost 40 years now. When his son turned 13, he invited me to a great big party that I never knew what it was before. He said, I'm going to invite you to my son's bar mitzvah. Some of y'all who've been to a bar mitzvah know what it's all about. We had a good time. We were singing and jumping around. And then at one particular point, we all picked up the kid's chair. La, 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 la. We were jumping. We were having ourselves a good time. It was a celebration. And it happened because of the physical connection of his Jewishness that was a part of his ethnic heritage. Oh, it was a good party. But I'm here to tell you something, child of God. When you got saved, when your name was added to the Lamb's Book of Life, they had a party up in heaven that was off the charts. It was a time of bar mitzvah bigger than anything they ever had down here. Because on that day, the ones who were dancing and the ones who were shouting were the angels in heaven. You and I were adopted. There was a celebration off the charts up there in which we were taken up from the depths of sin and destruction, and we were given the greatest name of all time. That is, as a born again child of God. That's the day I got my name, a new name, called the Son of God. Oh, yes, you did. Yes, you did. Come on, you can give God some praise. On that day, our names were written on the Lamb's Book of Life. Our sins were blotted out. And now you and I can lay claim to our spiritual connection with Father Abraham, who became not the father just of the Jews and Arabs, who impressively number in the millions. But in fact, we become a part of the innumerable nation who have had this blessed promise through faith in Jesus Christ, God's only begotten Son. I like how the Revelator showed the picture, and in my mind's eye, I can see it right now. There in heaven, says Revelation chapter 7, verse 9, there will be a multitude of folk, impossible to count, tongue of every tribe, all kind of folk of different colors. Up in heaven, it will be a rainbow coalition. Every kind of person you could think about. A sea of Gentiles who have been grafted into the family of God. Not by works of righteousness, but because of faith in Jesus Christ. Justified, cleansed, and forgiven. This is our heritage. And it is something that you and I can celebrate on this wonderful day. My friends, you and I are the children of Abraham because of our spiritual connection. Genesis shows us a picture of God's great promises to Abraham and to us, as seen thirdly in the promise of a great blessing. Genesis chapter 12, verse 2, I'm taking the B portion, A, B portion. And it says, and I will make of thee a great nation, and I will bless thee. Faith comes by hearing. So you need to keep on hearing and hearing and hearing and hearing by the word of God. Genesis chapter 12, this is a different translation. It says, get thee out of thy country and from thy kindred and from thy father's house unto a land that I will show thee. And the Lord answered, this is Exodus chapter 33, says, my presence, watch this, will go with you. And I, here it is, I will give you peace. Ooh. Philippians chapter 4, verse 7 said, then God's peace, which goes beyond anything we can imagine, will guard your thoughts and emotions through Christ Jesus. I believe that was a word for somebody right there. You've been going through all kind of stuff, but you just pray, ask for the peace of God that is beyond your understanding, will guard your heart and emotions. Next slide, James chapter 2. Verse 23, it says, and the scripture was fulfilled which said, Abraham believed God, and it was imputed unto him for righteousness, and he was called the friend of God. Here we go. Here in this third point, we want to explore and dive deeper into what it means to be blessed. One of the much used statements that are commonly spoken by Christians is sort of a greeting that we give to each other. Is, you know, you meet somebody and say, yeah, I'm blessed and highly favored. Now, my friends, I consider myself to be blessed and highly favored, but in preparation for this teaching, I was challenged to make sure that I understood fully what that meant. That I'm not just saying that as kind of a slogan here in the scriptures and relating some of these to the person of Abram, we understand more clearly the meaning and depth of God's great promise to Abraham. Now, I've used several scriptures, so bear with me in mind. Just bear with me just a little while. It'll come together. Genesis chapter 12, verse 1, it says that we can see that God is calling Abram into a personal relationship. Let me just go back a slide. You can see that. He's calling. He said, get out of your country. I need you to come and get close to me. He's taking Abraham away from his family so that Abram would be able to develop a closer and more intimate relationship with God. In Exodus, God said in speaking to his people, and this is true of his relationship with Abram, he said, and I quote, my presence will go with you and I will give you peace. Philippians 4, verse 7 says, and I quote, God's peace, which goes beyond anything we can imagine, slow down, will guard your thoughts and emotions. This points to some of what God meant when he promised that he would bless Abram. You see, God wanted Abram to know that he would, watch this, love him, and he would always be present and active in his life. God wanted Abram to know that he was calling him, watch this, into a relationship of exclusivity where he would hold Abram in a position of protection and peace. God wanted Abraham to understand that he would be guarded and protected under the shadow of the wings of God Almighty. This is something that you and I as children of the Most High can rest in and be encouraged of and reminded of, even as we look and learn about Abram. Child of God, to be blessed and highly favored is so much more than the kinds of things that we project that meaning. When we're thinking about stuff and money and power, and I got a new job, and I got myself a pair of Ferragamo shoes, I got myself an Xbox, and I'm blessed and highly favored because I live in a nice neighborhood and I got a job. But that is just stuff. The blessings of God are so much more than that. Oh, my friend, God's blessing means that he gives you peace. Some folk who are struggling right now in this COVID-19 situation, and it seems like every day it just gets worse and worse. I look at this stuff on CNN and MSNBC, and they got the graphs, and they're showing everything's going down the tubes. Now every state except California, a couple other states are going through another tough time. It seems, Lord, this, you hear about this stuff, it'll make you feel crazy. It'll make your head blow up. But something about the presence of God in your life, even as you see these things happening, the child of God can have peace. Sometimes that passes all understanding. Some of you know about this in your own job, in your workplace, with people you deal with, and they're pulling their hair out. I'm not saying that we're not concerned about this thing, but we don't lose a lot of sleep about it. We're not going crazy every day. We can just shut it down. Sometime when the crazy stuff begins to come through your mind, you can just pray and ask God to give you the peace that surpasses all understanding. Then you'll find yourself able to sleep. You'll find yourself able to function because you've got a gifting from God that is much more important and so much more powerful than whether you have some money, a job, or a car. God's blessing means you've got peace. It also means that you have strong sense of his indwelling presence. You know, Julius Harper's the kind of person who's wired to worry sometime. I'm not going to kid you and tell you my head is always screwed on right. Sometime I'll wake up at 2 o'clock worrying about some kind of foolishness. But you know, I've found that the one thing that will override all that is a sense to know that the Spirit of God is living in me. Some of y'all know exactly what I'm talking about. You know what I'm talking about, child of God. A sense of a knowledge of his ever-dwelling presence, no matter how crazy things may seem. You can know that the Spirit of God is dwelling in you. And I love the fact that the Bible calls Abram the friend of God. And this is something that you and I can embrace. Because just like we used to be the adversary, now we are the friend of God. Watch this, not because you were so good or so righteous that you deserve God's favor, but rather because, like Abraham believed, watch this, you became the beneficiary of an imputed righteousness, not because of what you did, but because of what you believed. Not by works of righteousness. Not by the amount you give, not by how many committees or teams you serve on. None of those things brought you into that blessed state of righteousness and acceptance. No, it came because of faith in Jesus the Christ, God's only Son. Genesis shows us a picture of God's great promises to Abram as seen fourthly in the promise of a great name. Here it says, and I will bless thee and make thy name great. Faith comes by hearing by the word of God. Got up several scriptures here. Stay with me. Genesis chapter 17, verse 4 through 5, it says, my promise is still with you. You will become the father of many nations, so your name will no longer be Abram, which means exalted father, but Abraham, here it is, father of many, because I've made you a father of many nations. But as many as received him, to them gave he power to become the sons of God, even to them that believe on his name. Here it is, which were born not of blood, nor the will of the flesh, nor the will of man, but of God. One more slide for you. Here we go. Revelation. Him that overcometh, this is Jesus. These are the words of Jesus being spoken to the Revelator. Him that overcometh will I make a pillar in the temple of my God, and he shall go no more out. And I will write upon him the name of my God and the name of the city of my God, which is New Jerusalem, which cometh down out of heaven from my God. And I will write upon him my new name. Here in this portion of the scripture, read that God declares and promises that Abram's name would become great. Abraham, of course, is one of the most important people in the Bible. 14 chapters of the book of Genesis are devoted to Abraham more than any other person in the book of Genesis. As we discussed earlier, Abraham became the father of two great nations. He's called the Prince of God in Genesis chapter 3, chapter 23, verse 6. He's identified as a prophet in Genesis chapter 20, verse 7. He's described as the servant of God in the 106th Psalm, verse 5. In the New Testament, the life of Abraham is discussed as an example to the true believer, and in Romans, Abraham is presented as the father of all who believe. The promise that God made to Abram, who gave him the name of Abraham, bear with me, is the same promise, watch this, that is made to every born-again child of God. See, Abraham was given the name of exalted father. Watch this. But through Jesus Christ, you and I have been given, you know it. Come on, say it. You've been given the name of son, the son of God. Those of us who are old enough to remember a miniseries written by Alex Haley, remember the movie called Roots, or Roots, as my mother used to say, Roots. One of the most powerful scenes in the film revolved around the fact that Kunta Kinte, his name was taken away from him, and he was forced to go by the name of Toby. That name defined him as someone's property, and it was a symbol of the bondage in which he was held. That's the way it was before Jesus came and freed us from the bonds of sin and death. You and I were held in bondage by sin. We were held and we were defined by the chains of sin and death that dominated our lives. But when we were saved, we were given brand new names. My old name was Julius A. Harper, a sinner on his way to a devil's hell. Your old name, fill in the blank, used to be blank sinner on your way to a devil's hell. But now, my friend, a new name is written on my forehead. Instead of Julius A. Harper on his way to a devil's hell, written on my name is Julius the Washed, Julius the Cleansed, Julius the Sanctified, and Julius the Justified on his way to heaven. How about you, my friends? Do you know the new name? Do you have a new name on your head? And do you know that a place has been prepared for you as a place for you in the temple of God? Child of God, you and I have been given that name because we were born again, not of blood, nor of the will of the flesh, nor of the will of man, but the will of God. The Bible says he has prepared a place for us in the temple of his God. The Bible says in a place in the heavens made not with hands. You and I are going to be there. That's our spiritual heritage. That's where we're going. Up in heaven with our new spiritual bodies on which a name will be written, the name of our God written on our foreheads. That's our spiritual heritage. Come on, give God some praise here today. He's given us a great name. The name Julius Harper, before I got saved, had a lot of stuff attached to it. But thank God. Somebody can say, you can say, yeah, that was me too. You can say that was me too. But when God saved you, when he saved me, he gave me a new name. He gave you a new name. You're a saint of God, washed, cleansed, forgiven, watch this, and protected within the beloved. Genesis shows us a picture of God's great promises to Abraham and to us, as seen fifth and finally in the promise of being a blessing to others. It said, I will bless thee and make thy name great, and thou shalt be a blessing. Faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. Speaking to Abraham, it says, when there was nothing left to hope for, Abraham still hoped and believed. Watch this. As a result, he became a father of many nations. Romans says he didn't doubt God's promise out of lack of faith, instead giving honor to God for the promise. He became strong because of faith. I love this. Here's 1 Peter chapter 1. It says, to an inheritance incorruptible and undefiled that fadeth not away, reserved in heaven for you. Here it is. Who are kept by the power of God through faith unto salvation, ready to be revealed the last time. Earlier in the sermon, I touched briefly upon the two great nations that trace their physical lineage to the person of Abraham. Here, as we conclude our teaching today, we once again want to look at the blessings that came into this world through the Jewish people. Most of the important laws and principles of this United States came to us through the Jewish people. You know, I know that there are many twisted and perverted people who want to discount the blessing of the Jews. But I'm here to tell you that this country, the greatness of this country, was not because the founding fathers were so brilliant. No, it was founded on Judeo-Christian principles. The name of Abraham was great, and the Jewish people who came out of him were a great blessing to the world. But the real blessing, watch this. The real blessing and the ultimate promise to which this scripture reminds us, watch this, is to be seen in and celebrated in the person of Yeshua, known as Jesus the Christ. Ultimately, the promise of God and the blessings associated therewith came to us through the person of Jesus Christ. That is what is spoken of in Genesis chapter 12, verse 2, which says, and I quote, "And I will bless them that bless thee, and curse him that curseth thee, and in thee shall all the families of the earth be blessed." It was through Jesus Christ, the seed of Abram, that we received the promise of a new land. It was the promise given to Abraham that you and I can now embrace and flow in the reality of our new spiritual heritage through faith because of Jesus Christ. That's how we became sons and daughters of God. Now we who were outside of the family of God, we were aliens outside of the commonwealth of Israel, but we become a new nation in Jesus Christ, and now we are now numbered among the redeemed. Child of God, that's who you are. And for that, every born again child of God ought to give God some praise. Come on, praise him. Come on and praise him. Come on and give God some Holy Ghost praise. Amen. Part of the blessing of this great spiritual heritage is that God has given us the privilege of sharing some great news with you, my friend. The message of Abram's life is a message of God's great love and mercy that flowed to Abraham because of faith. The gospel and the good news of salvation is that forgiveness of sins is available through faith in Jesus Christ. What you talking about, preacher? Don't I have to do something? No, you got to confess with your mouth and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead. The good news is that Abram left a pattern for us to follow. The roadmap is clear. The Bible says that if thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus and shalt believe in thy heart that God has raised him from the dead, here it is, thou shalt be saved. Here's the kicker. For with the heart man believeth unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. My friend, my unsaved friend, God is calling men and women, boys and girls. He's calling people just like you to the promised land, to a life eternal of peace with God through Jesus Christ. God is beckoning us. God is beckoning you to the promise of a new spiritual heritage in which you can be blessed to have a new relationship of peace with God. I'm telling you, there's practically no way I can explain how good it feels to know that if you die tonight, and every person here, you, my friend, are a candidate for death. Folk have a lot of things to worry about, but the one thing that a child of God does not have to worry about is where their soul will spend eternity if they leave this earth. And every single person, no matter how healthy you may be, how matter you work out, doesn't matter what your age is, you are a candidate for death. My friend, if you don't have that peace that surpasses all understanding, if you do not have that peace that guards your heart, I'm not telling you that everything in my life is peachy, neat old boss, and I just go along skipping along like I'm some kind of a weirdo. I have all kind of stuff going on, but I don't have to worry about my eternal soul. I can access the power and the peace of God. Do you know that for yourself? Would you like to know that if you don't know it? My friend, if you want to receive Jesus Christ as Lord of your life, I want you to bow your head and close your eyes and pray this prayer with me. Say, Lord Jesus, I need you in my heart. I know that I've been an independent sinner, guilty of sin, rebellion, arrogance, and pride. I've tried to do it myself. I know that I can't do it. I'm lost and on my way to hell. So I'm opening up my heart. I'm asking you to save me, Lord Jesus. Come into my life. I believe you died for my sins, that you rose again, and that you're seated at the right hand of the Father, that you are God, and I give my life to you. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Now, my friend, if you prayed that prayer, and meant it from your heart. You can believe according to the scriptures that I just shared with you that you're a born-again child of God. Find a pastor if you're in our area here in the Santa Cruz Valley. We are still on COVID lockdown, but you can reach out to us via text or email. Text is the easy way to do it, 661-298-8189. If you are not in our area, find a pastor, preacher, elder, minister at church. Let that person know you've accepted Jesus Christ as Lord. Welcome, my friend, to the family of God. God bless you, my beloved. Amen. Amen. Now, we've come to the end of another online service, and I just thank the Lord for allowing us to be here together. I mean, it's been 7+ months that God has just kept us, and we've been able to gather, and that's a very important thing. Don't take it for granted that we are able to gather this way and be connected to one another. I want to encourage you. Now, next Saturday, because this is the 25th, next Saturday, between the hours of 5 to 7 p.m., again, we're going to be hosting a drive-through candy and goodie bag giveaway. This is going to be a touchless event for us to minister to the people in this neighborhood and also to our church members. So get your kids. If you don't have a kid, you can still, you like candy, come on by. We'll put a goodie bag in your car, and we're going to do that Saturday, 5 to 7 p.m. So we look forward to seeing you. Pray for us if you're not going to be able to make it. Again, we would encourage as many of you who can come to be here, maybe just to hang out. Here's the deal, though, and make sure you understand very clearly. We're going to continue to practice social distancing and a face mask. When you're at home, if you don't believe in face masks, do whatever you want. But when you come on to Santa Cruz Christian Fellowship, for the sake of our brothers and sisters in Christ and the witness of our church, we're going to comply with that. Okay, so make sure you do that. If you're like, I'm not wearing a mask, this is not an event for you, stay home and pray for us, okay? I just want to make sure we're very clear about that. We're going to have a very good time, so let's look forward to it. Now, before I dismiss with the prayer, a couple of things. Wednesday Bible study at 7:30. I want to encourage you to join in on the stream. And Monday night at 7 o'clock, Girlfriend's Guide to God, an excellent Bible study and discussion group. If you want more details, you'll find that on our website at www.myscf.com. All right, let's pray. Father God, thank you so much for the gathering of your people. Thank you for your word, Lord God. Help us to be encouraged thereby. Thank you, Lord God, for your great promises, for your promised land, for a new name that you've given us, Lord God. No longer do we have to take it X as our last name. Oh, Lord, thank you that our name is Son of God. Thank you so much that you've done that. As we go on about our various tasks and duties, Lord, keep us safe in the palm of your mighty hands and bring us back again to the appointed time that we may lift high your name. This we ask in Jesus' name. Amen. Now raise your hand, repeat after me. And now may the grace of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ and the sweet communion of the Holy Spirit rest, rule, and abide henceforth now and forevermore. And all the people of God said, amen. Hug yourself. We can't hug each other. Hug yourself. Hug your family. We'll see you next week. God bless you. Great day. Bye-bye.